Hi everyone, this is Manpreet. I work at Hotstar as an Android engineer. Previously, I have led Android development in multiple startups in India. So I've always been curious about how people are breaking the apps that we Android developers are building. My curiosity has taught me a few things, and today I'm here to share that knowledge with all of you. So Wikipedia's Android app is open source, so I'm not getting into any legal trouble by changing it and rebuilding it. One thing to keep in mind is that we are not going to touch its original source, so whatsoever we'll do on the Wikipedia's release version APK. So let's choose the first thing to break. We can see that there is a menu item that takes us to the donation page of the Wikipedia app. Now, my motivation is to change the donation URL to one of my own URL. We can guess why a few people might be interested in doing exactly this. I'm interested in changing it to my Twitter URL because I want more followers. So to change the URL, we have to analyze the APK and figure out that how Wikipedia is internally storing this URL. So what we are getting into is reverse engineering here. And to reverse the engineering, we have to first understand it. So let's get us the answer for this question. I see the engineering of APK as a three-step process. Let's explore this one by one. Resources are everything that are present in the resource folder of Android Studio, Android project, and along with the Android manifest. So resource bundling is handled by Android asset packaging tool, that is AAPT2. AAPT2 does that in two steps. First one is the compilation of the resources, and the second one is the linking of the compiled resources. So we can see that in the first phase, AAPT2 is taking the resources and giving us the intermediary representation. That is a zip file. So this is the output of the first phase in a way. So it's taking the resource values and giving us the resource table, that is of the extension .arsc.flat. And other XML resources are just compiled onto the files with .xml.flat extension. And the PNGs are converted to png.png.flat. This is a compressed version of PNGs. So AAPT do the lossless compression on PNGs to give us the compressed PNGs. So we got this resource.zip in the first phase of the AAPT2. And then this resource.zip file is actually taken by the AAPT2 for the linking phase. And AAPT2 just link all the resources that are present in the resource in this zip and give us the resources table. This resources table contain all the entries of all the resources that are present in our app. So we'll look into that later on. And it also generates the r.java. We must be familiar with r.java because we use it to access the resources for any of our needs. So yeah, so this is the first step. Now, we mostly write Java or Kotlin code that gets converted to DEX at the end of the day. So we know that we have r.java that was generated by AAPT2, and there's another Java files that we have written by ourselves. And these are, at the end of the day, taken by the Java or Kotlin compiler and converted into the bytecode that can be optionally optimized by ProGuard to give us the optimized class file. But at the end of the day, it has to go through the D8 or DX to give out the DEX files. So yeah, these are the two steps. Now, in the last step of the APK bundling, it will take the DEX file that was generated by the DEX generation step and the APT2 output that was the APK which was carrying the resources.arsc and other resources. But that output was actually, that APK, we can't install it yet on the actual device because it doesn't contain the DEX file. So what happens in the APK bundling phase, it merges these together to give us the unsigned APK. But again, unsigned APK can't be installed on the device because we need to sign it with our keystore. A keystore is nothing but a private key that we use to sign our APKs. So it can happen in two ways. If we are using APK signer, we have to use GPLine is again optional. It's just optimize the uncompressed resources in our app. So the memory, it will be better to do it, but it's not compulsory to do it. So when we are running it through the Android Studio, it's actually doing the GPLining as well. So the other way is by using the jar signer. Yeah. So at the end of the day, we are getting the APK that we needed. So let's look. Go back to this. And we know that what we want. We want to change the donation URL in Wikipedia app. So we have to figure out where this donation URL might be present. The first thing is resources.arsc that I want to peek inside. But I can see only binary content, and I can't understand binary content well. So we need some help. Let's take help from a member of Android Studio family here, APK Analyzer. It does understand the binary format. We'll try to use it to analyze Wikipedia's APK. So I uploaded Wikipedia's APK to APK Analyzer. It is showing me the content of the APK. We can see the output of the resource bundling, that is resources.arc and resource file, and the dex generation phase. Again, what we are interested in is looking into resources.arc file. Let's do that. So here it is. Finally, we reached there. Resources.arc has all the resources-related information. As I said earlier, it maps all the resource IDs to the actual content. We can see the defined strings through it, here. I found the string of interest, that is donate URL. Now I just want to change it and rebuild the APK. But I can't edit the resources in APK Analyzer. It just helps us in analyzing the APK content. Then how will we change it? APK tool, because we need awesome tools. It can disassemble the resource bundled in APK to nearly original form, and then it can rebuild. Then it can rebuild the resources back to the APK. This is exactly what we want. Change the donation URL and then rebuild the APK. It also has an integration for Smolly and BackSmolly. We'll look into that later. So this is the command with which we can decode the wiki APK into wiki decoded folder. We can see that it's decoding the XML values over here. This is what we are interested in for now. Earlier by APK Analyzer, we saw that donation URL is defined in strings as a string. So I'll just look into the wiki decoder folder that is the output of this command. And I can see there is a resource folder over here. So our strings.xml must be in the resource folder. So let's check that. Yeah, I found it. I found the donation URL. And now I just want to change it to my Twitter URL. Yeah. So finally, we made the change over here. Now we can build the Wikipedia's APK with these changes in it. And again, it is very easy because we have an awesome tool with us, that is APK tool. It will build the wiki decoded folder, and we can see that it's actually building the resources again. And we made the change in the resources folder of wiki decoded folder. So yeah, we got the APK, but still it is not signed APK, so we can't install it on our device yet. So we need to sign it. I'm doing it through jar signer, and I'm using my debug keystore to do that. So the private key that is coming to sign the APK is coming from the debug keystore. And now I can install the APK. Me becoming more popular. So what's next? So this was all about modifying resources. But resources is just one part of APK. While keeping this in mind, let's pick our next challenge. Let's steal wiki credential, because everybody has wiki account. It looks like we need to get into the code for this use case. So we can see that login flow looks like this for Wikipedia app at present. So we know that DEX is a binary format, so I can't, again, read this. So I need to change it back to the Java or Kotlin file to analyze what's happening inside the DEX. So I can do it using many tools. One of the tools is JDXGGY. So I'm using it to see what's there in the Wikipedia app. So this is the code that we got from the Wikipedia APK. We can see that the code is not obfuscated. It's in totally readable format. So it's very easy to get a sense of what's happening inside Wikipedia app. I can do static analysis without pulling my hairs. Now to see the login flow, we want to reach the login screen in this app. Let us guess the name of the login screen. Login activity? Yeah, I found one. I searched for this in JADX and I found the login activity. This is a file that I'm interested in. Now let me guess the name of the function that will do the login in the login activity. Do login? Quite close. Yeah, so there is a function do login, and I can see the references of username and password in it. This is the information that I'm interested in, Wikipedia's username and password. So what I can do, I can just inject my code over here and use this information the way I want. I think this is very easy for me, but life is not that easy. Dex to Java compilation might not work at times. So there are few methods in Wikipedia APK that JDX is not able to decompile. I'm not sure of why it's happening, but it happens for most of the apps. So we can't recompile the Java source that we had gotten from JDX. And if we can't recompile, we can't get the compromised APK. So we are not getting the login credentials. Now what? Let's meet Smalley. Smalley will help us here. Smalley is the bytecode representation that is human readable form of for Dex file. So we can use Backsmalley to convert the Dex file to Smalley bytecode. Again, it's a human readable. And I can again use Smalley to convert the Smalley bytecode to the Dex. So yes, for some reason, the assembler and their bytecode format, both are called Smalley. And it can be used as verb as well. So I can use Smalley to Smalley the Smalley bytecode. I'm so excited to look at the Smalley representation. For this, let's get back to our old friend, APK Analyzer. Yeah, APK Analyzer can also convert the Dex file to Smalley bytecode for us. I hope you still remember do login method from login activity. It's hard to remember, but still. Let's see its Smalley representation. I think I'm not human. Human readable format is not that readable to me. Still, it's not a binary format. Now we need to add few lines of our Smalley code in Smalley code of login activity to get the username and password. We know that the easiest way to show information in Android is by showing toast. So for the sake of the demo, we'll show the toast with username and password of Wikipedia in it. For that, we have to add our show toast method to the login activity. So this is a method in the login activity Smalley code. So we'll add one more method, that is a show toast method. And then we'll call that show toast method with username and password in it. So let's do that. But again, I haven't registered as Android developer to write code while considering registers. So I don't want to write assembly code, no worries. Let's go back to the reverse engineering. I like copy and pasting code. No, I'm not talking about Stack Overflow here. We'll generate a Smalley code to show toast by making use of Java code so that we can copy paste that Smalley code to Smalley code of login activity. I made a simple method, show toast in Java, that takes the username and password and it will just show a toast out of that. We know that we can generate Dex from the code written in Java by running Java C on it followed by DX. So this is what I'll do. I'll generate a Dex file out of my Smalley file, that is this file, and then I will run Backsmalley on top of it to get the Smalley code. We got it. This is what Smalley code of show toast method looks like. Obviously, I don't want to write assembly code by myself. So now we need to copy and paste this method in login activity, but again, we can't edit anything in APK analyzer. So let's again get back to APK tool. As we saw with resources, APK tool also helps us in disassembling the Dex file to Smalley and then reassembling Smalley code back to Dex. So let's make Smalley changes. What exactly are we doing here? I pasted the generated Smoly bytecode of the showToast method in the bytecode of the login activity. Now I just need to call my showToast method from do login while passing username and password as arguments. I figured out that if I stare at Smoly code for a long time, it might make sense to me. So we can see that the value of username input is getting stored in the V0 register here. And then we are calling getText method while passing V0 as a value. So that's a username input again. Now it will give us the character sequence back. And we'll call toString method on this character sequence to get back the string representation of username input. So at the end of the day, we move the result back to V3 register. We are doing the same with the password field, and we are getting the result back to V4 register. So these two are the registers of interest here, and I just need to pass this to my showToast method that I just copy-pasted after generating from Java source. And this is it. Now it should show the toast. But before that, I have to build the Wikidecoded app, and I can see there that it is smalling the Smoly folder. So that's how we get the compromised APK. So it's printing out the username and password in the toast. We can change it to something else if we want, like sending this credential to my own server. But it was very easy because it was not sophisticated code. Now let's have a peek at how the sophisticated code looks like. Now let's guess the login screen name, ABC. BBC, NSA. I don't think the static analysis will help me much in understanding the sophisticated code of WhatsApp. What might help me is line-by-line debugging. Yeah, we can do that on release version of APK as well. Let's see how. This is just a four-step process. First, we need to decode the APK to get the original source back. Then we'll make a change in the Android manifest to add the Android debuggable flag. And at the end of the day, after making this change, we have to build our APK back and use the Smoly IDEA plugin in our own Android Studio. This is all, and we'll get something like this. Step-by-step debugging. You must have got the idea that it can help a lot to understand the sophisticated code. After understanding, we can make the change in Smoly and rebuild the app as we did earlier. It's a tedious process that I don't want to get into for now. Let's do something else. Let's do something big. This time, the important password of users, not just Wikipedia password. So we'll track what's getting typed in any of the edit text across our whole Android system. So we'll get the password, all the passwords. Here I'm showing the password from, okay. Yeah, from Facebook app. Again, the question is how? So let's answer this. By using exposed framework. So it need a root access, but it will give you the power to hook before or after any method from any app. So, and guess what? You don't even need to decompile the apps, so original signature will work as it is. Many people are actively building modules for exposed and distributing it. So if you have exposed installed in your device, then you can make use of these community modules. Again, should you make use of exposed module that are available on the internet? To answer it, let's see how exposed have this much power. You might have seen crashes with zygote in it. So it's the first process that Android starts, and every other Android app then fork or can say copy from it. From high level, exposed just replaces that process with its own implementation that allows it to hook or before or after any method and call our code as required from the exposed module. It's doing it because exposed bridge.jar is available for all the apps as it is added to the class path of every app. So yeah, we got it working by using this hook. So your hook looks something like this in the exposed. This is a part of bigger Android project, so that you need to set up in some particular way for exposed to recognize it as a module. You can check exposed wiki for that. I will add the link for that in the later in the resources section. Here, handle load package will get called for all the apps that are running on our in our system. So whenever any package is loaded, this is where I have put the hook for the on focus change method. And I actually just, you know how much I love the toast. So I'll just show the toast with the content of the edit text. So we got it. We got the password, username and password of all the apps in the compromised device. I don't expect all of you to hack into apps after this talk. My main intention was to make you all aware of how people are breaking our apps so that we can try to secure it better. So this talk is about making things harder for people to break your apps. And for that to happen, we have to keep a few things in mind. We have to make few changes as we saw in earlier that how people are breaking things. We will have to keep that in mind and we have to make few changes as we are doing things now. So we saw how easy it was to look into the string and replace them. So be aware of it. Never keep your secrets in string.xml. We also saw that it was very easy to understand unsophisticated code of Wikipedia. I knew exactly what method is being called without even looking at the source code. So obfuscate it using proper ProGuard configuration, hopefully without using keep flag for ProGuard for most of the classes. And to make things harder for rebuilding and redistribution of Android app, we can validate the app signature at the client side. Actually, WhatsApp is doing that, and in that screenshot or the video that I showed earlier, I was trying to analyze how it's doing it, just for learning purpose. If you want to check that the device that you're running your app on is not rooted, then you can make use of safety net APIs by Google. Also be aware that it's possible to change the is premium flag in your shared preferences or database. So these are the resources that I have referred to while doing everything that I did in the talk. So in the end, I want to highlight that I'm currently working for Hotstar, most popular video streaming platform in India, where we are building Android app for millions of our users. So we have our offices in India and China. So, and just like every other company here, we are also hiring. So if you are interested, then you should definitely check tech.hotstar.com. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Any queries or questions? Yeah? The question is about how we can validate the app signature, right? Yeah. So again, the code will stay at the client side when you will try to validate the app signature, but you will try to hide it somewhere. We know that our app is getting signed by our key store, release key store, and we know the private public key of that, so we can get it from inside our code. And we can just try to validate that, is this the key which we signed our app? And we'll try to hide it somewhere in the code so that people don't find that logic. Because at the end of the day, all the logic is at the client side. And again, it's just making things harder. Just security is, you can't get 100% security, so it can be broken. Yeah. So WhatsApp is putting some logic where it takes random bytes from SHA and try to validate that somehow. Yeah. Any other question? Yeah. Encrypt it. Encrypt if you have something that is very valuable to you, then encrypt it and only decrypt it after getting some sort of salt from backend or something like that. There are shared preferences, a secure version of shared preferences. I can, if you will get in touch after the talk, I can point you to that thing. So you can use that to store the values in the shared preferences. Any other question? I hope I answered your question, right? Yeah. Anything else? We have a lot of time for questions. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Thanks a lot for your time. That's it.